I welcome you to this service of the Holy Eucharist during this season of Pentecost, the longest season in the church year. It commemorates the descending of the Holy Spirit on the followers of Christ and marks the beginning of the Christian church and its mission to the world. As we journey through Pentecost, may you be blessed by the Holy Spirit with good health and happiness as you share God's love with your family, friends, and those in need in our community and throughout the world. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, the fountain of all wisdom, you know our necessities before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Have compassion on our weakness and mercifully give us those things which for our unworthiness we dare not, and for our blindness we cannot ask, through the worthiness of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Collect for Transition. Almighty God, you have called us as you called those who came before us into lively and holy ministry in this cathedral parish, to be your light in this corner of the world. In this time of change, send, we pray, your Holy Spirit to comfort and guide us, to help us discover who we are and what we may become. As we prepare for a new shepherd of your flock, a minister in your house, grant us patience, discernment, and grace in all our uncertainties, and bless our search for one to lead us as the church you call us to be through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
A reading from the second book of Samuel. When the king settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See now, I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan. "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day. But I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among all the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?' Now, therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, 'Thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, to be prince over my people Israel. And I have been with you wherever you went, and have cut off all your enemies from before you, and I will make for you a great name, like the names of the great ones of earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them, so that they may live in their own place, and be disturbed no more, and evildoers shall afflict them no more, as formerly from the time that I appointed judges over my people. And I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house. When your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come forth from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me." The word of the Lord. Psalm 89, verses 20 through 37. "I have found David, my servant, with my holy oil have I anointed him. My hand will hold him fast, and my arm will make him strong. No enemy shall deceive him, nor any wicked man bring him down. I will crush his foes before him and strike down those who hate him. My faithfulness and love will be with him, and he shall be victorious through my name. I shall make his dominion extend from the great sea to the river. He will say to me, 'You are my Father, my God, and the rock of my salvation.' I will make him my firstborn and higher than the kings of the earth. I will keep my love for him forever, and my covenant will stand firm for him. I will establish his line forever and his throne as the days of heaven. If his children forsake my law and do not walk according to my judgments, if they break my statutes and do not keep my commandments, I will punish their transgressions with a rod and their iniquities with the lash. But I will not take my love from him, nor let my faithfulness prove false. I will not break my covenant, nor change what has gone out of my lips. Once for all, I have sworn by my holiness, I will not lie to David. His line shall endure forever, and his throne as the sun before me. It shall stand fast forevermore, like the moon, the abiding witness in the sky."
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark. The apostles gathered around Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. He said to them, "Come away to a deserted place all by yourselves and rest a while. For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. And they went away in the boat to a deserted place by themselves. Now many saw them going and recognized them, and they hurried there on foot from all the towns and arrived ahead of them. As he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them because they were like sheep without a shepherd, and he began to teach them many things. When they had crossed over, they came to land at Gennesaret and moored the boat. When they got out of the boat, people at once recognized him and rushed about that whole region and began to bring the sick on mats to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he went, into villages or cities or farms, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and begged him that they might touch even the fringe of his cloak, and all who touched it were healed. The Gospel of the Lord.
I speak to you in the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The world into which Saul of Tarsus was born was a world in which people were divided into two camps. The first camp, the Jews, that is, the chosen people of God, the one to whom God had been revealed, the one to whom all the promises of Hebrew Scripture had been made. The second camp, the Gentiles, that is, everyone else. In the world of Saul of Tarsus, the Jews were the us, and the Gentiles were them. 1900 years later, the English writer Rudyard Kipling said, "East is east, and west is west, and never the twain shall meet." He was not just making that up. He was reflecting the reality of the world in which he lived. Could it be that there is something deep in human nature that makes us want to divide the world into them and us, that causes us to choose sides, to draw dividing lines, to build up walls? There are so many ways in which we do this. In some places, it is about the language that you speak, or which side of the tracks you come from. Maybe it is about Christian versus Muslim, immigrant versus native born, labor versus management, rich versus poor. We humans are good at building walls, tangible and intangible walls. Some of them have names: the Iron Curtain, the Berlin Wall. Some are unnamed, but just as real. However, this is not the way of Jesus Christ. Today, in Paul's letter to the Ephesians, we heard, he has made both groups into one, and has broken down the dividing wall, that is, the hostility between us. Something there is that doesn't love a wall, wrote the great American poet Robert Frost. Rather, we could say, someone there is who does not love a wall, and that someone is Jesus Christ himself. The one who came to break down the dividing walls of our world. As followers of Jesus Christ, it is up to us to continue that work, to break down those walls wherever we see them and to be careful lest we contribute to building or even maintaining them. We need to examine our lives and our hearts to find those invisible but very real barriers that we can so easily erect between ourselves and our fellow human beings. East is east, and west is west, and never the twain shall meet, is not the reality in the world we must inherit as Christians. As St. Paul writes in the letter to the Galatians, there is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male and female. For all of us are one in Christ Jesus. In a world that constantly encourages the us versus them mentality, the Christian message is that there is no them. There is only us, all of us, in the same boat, members of the same body, with Christ as the head. There is an ancient legend that paints a vivid picture of what heaven and hell look like. In this ancient picture, there is a giant banquet room with tables filled with all sorts of wonderful things to eat and drink. The people are all seated at the tables, but they are chained up in such a way that they can pick up the food, but the chains prevent them from bringing the food to their mouths. In the ultimate irony, they are dying of starvation with food in their hands. In this legend, there is another banquet room with tables filled with all the same wonderful items to eat and drink, and the people are chained just as before. But in this banquet room, the people are laughing and enjoying themselves. The difference? Heaven is filled with people who could not feed themselves, but the chains would allow them to feed each other. Let us pray. O God, you have made of one blood all the peoples of the earth, and sent us your blessed Son to preach peace to those who are far off and to those who are near. Grant that people everywhere may seek after you and find you. Amen.
In this season of Pentecost, let us pray to the Lord with all our hearts and with all our minds, saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray for the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among the nations and peoples. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray for the church, that it may carry forward the redemptive work of God, healing, feeding, sheltering, and caring for one another. Guide our bishops, Michael and Brian, the clergy, staff, and people of St. Michael's. Give us faith to follow where you lead. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray for all those in positions of public trust, especially the president, our governor, and our mayor, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and well-being of all people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray for all people who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, and all those whose health, loved ones, or livelihood have been affected by the coronavirus. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray for the members of the cathedral family who have died and for their families in their grief. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray for our own needs and the needs of others, remembering especially those in the military, teachers, and the service industry. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Now I greet you in the name of Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you. And now walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Our service continues with the great thanksgiving. We offer this Eucharist to the glory of God in thanksgiving for the coming of Christ into our lives and into the life of the world. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he'd given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he'd given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father. In this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace, and at the last day bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. In union, O Lord, with your faithful at every altar of your church, where the Holy Eucharist is now being celebrated, we desire to offer to you praise and thanksgiving. We remember your death. We proclaim your resurrection. We await your coming in glory. Since we cannot receive you today in the sacrament of your body and blood, we beseech you to come spiritually into our hearts. Cleanse and strengthen us with your grace, and let us never be separated from you. May we live in you and you in us, in this life and in the life to come. Amen. The prayer of thanksgiving. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Good people, our Eucharist has ended. As you go forth to continue your work in the world, I bid you, be of good cheer. Hold fast to that which is good. Love and serve the Lord with gladness and singleness of heart, rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. And the blessings of God the Father who created us, God the Son who died for us, God the Holy Spirit who enlivens and makes us whole, be upon you this day and forevermore. Amen.
Let us go forth into the world, rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Thanks be to God.